Hello, everyone. It's another episode of the Creative Talk with my buddy here, Lucas. And we have a special guest today for this episode, a digital creator, a very awesome human being. I've been following this guy. I know his content is really solid. He makes a powerful impact in the digital world. It's all welcome, Kamal.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much, man, for having me. And I'm looking forward for this. It's going to be great. And let's see where this takes us.
Right. Okay. So, come
on,
bro.
I hope it doesn't take us to the jail like in the last episode.
No, I'm a fan of this guy. I'm a fan of Kamal.
Me too.
Yeah. The reason why I have a very few online personalities that I follow. But there's a lot of, you know, very skilled, very talented. But I have a very few personalities that I really admire. It's because I find them very authentic. I'm not saying, you know, all of them are clone or something. We are all unique. I think that's my recent post, that we are all unique. We don't compare. And we're all, you know, perfect in our own perspective,
exactly.
Right? But this guy, Kamal, man, solid, just solid.
That's the way, I think, from my perspective, that's the way to actually make it on Instagram or in the digital world. Like, everybody, we all say the same things. We all say the same information. Everybody can go to Google and Google the same information we're all talking about. But what makes the difference is who is saying it and how you're saying it.
Yeah.
So that's
is that a siren that I hear?
Yep.
Okay.
You get used. They're
Lucas,
coming from us.
Lucas,
they found us.
They found us, Lucas. You see, I told you, he's not even opening up his story, and a siren.
Siren's beginning.
Dude, crazy. No, bro, come on. Share us your story, man. I'm excited. Share us your story.
Okay, so I don't know if you guys saw. A week ago, I shared a post of what I used to do. So I did a lot of things. I played soccer. I'm a bartender. I did animations. And I'm doing this right now. And I also did guitar, skateboard. Like, I tried many different things because I love to try things. I love to see what I love. And I think this is what everybody should do. Like, yes, you should niche down, but not do it too early. And not do it too precise, but because you don't know what you love. I still don't know what I truly love. Mm. Unless you try it, you won't know. And unless you do it and you experience it and you fail at it, you won't know. So that's what I try to do. I try to experiment as much as I can with everything I find interesting.
What do you do
right now? I'm a content creator. I manage my page and I manage social media pages for the businesses. And also I'm a bartender. So currently with the COVID, the places are not opening. So this is currently on hold. But I used to bartend on weekends. So I used to go to bartending at night, weekends, have fun, network with people. A lot of my clients, actually, three of my clients came just because of people I met in the bar. Three of my clients at the bar. So that's a great way to network. And
that's
also
nice.
I like to spend my time, like at night when I finish work at 10, 11 p.m., I go to the local pub, I just sit with my friends. And I also posted a story about it last week that I managed to get a client just from talking to someone. Like I was sitting alone at the bar, and suddenly a big old guy was sitting, stuck in conversation with him. Hello, my name is Kamal. I do this. And apparently he has a business that's opening and he needs a content creator. He needs a social media manager. So this is what networking is. Like, networking is just not just commenting, posting comments. Networking is actually talking with people, actually connecting with them.
Who influential, what influenced you to think this way?
Well, if you mean, what taught me is, first of all, Gary Vee, you probably know that I'm a huge, huge supporter of Gary Vee. I watch a lot of his stuff. I like the way he thinks. Mm. I like the way he handles stuff.
Right.
But I don't take it on myself because, as you know, everybody's journey is different. Everybody's thinking is different. So I kind of take what he says and put it to my perspective. Though I really love doing what he's asking me to do. Like, he says post 5 to 10 times a day on multiple platforms. And I ask myself, do I really want to do that? Do I love to do that? Or I'm just doing that because he told me so. And a lot of the times I find that, yes, I'm interested in that. So he is like one of the most people I kind of follow on a daily basis. And other than that, I just want to enjoy.
I have a catch on this. I also follow Gary Vee a lot, and I think he's a very smart guy, but he has one thing. He has an extreme positive energy, and he can handle things. He's a very tough guy, you know, because I try to follow all his tips and try to post everywhere, try to post every single thing.
It's very hard right now.
I have stories, I have my feed, I have YouTube channel, I have a Skillshare course. So I'm constantly posting everywhere. And, but on the beginning, I tried to do the thing that he says. Between your 20s and your 30s, you should be working all day long, the maximum that you can. Yeah. And I tried to do this. But then I felt that I wasn't strong enough to do this, because after 4 months working almost 15 hours a day, I had a kind of a breakdown, and I stayed the next 4 months without being able to do almost anything, because I was completely drowned in my work. I was drained. I haven't energy to do anything I wanted to do, but my body rejected everything that I tried to do.
Yeah,
I was willing to create new content, to create a YouTube channel, to create TikTok. I was talking with Jen, I think it was two conversations ago, with Lucas, the TikTok on the clock media.
Yeah.
And I was talking to him, to both of you, and I haven't started my TikTok at that moment. And it was because I was just going out of that situation that's stressful and strange situation that I have been through, where I just wanted to do things, but my body rejected everything, because I stayed 4 months from the minute I was up to the minute I was going to sleep, sleeping 6 hours a day, working like 15 hours a day, and I wasn't able to keep up with this rhythm. Now I'm trying to, I'm recovered now. I can wake up early every single day and work like 10 to 12 hours a day, but this is my limit. Probably Gary Vee's limit is 15 hours, but you have to know your limits, because in my case, I discovered that my limit is 12 hours a day, 11 hours a day maximum.
That's exactly what I mean. That's exactly what I mean. Like I see what he says, but I don't apply it word by word. I see if it fits with my life. So honestly, for me, I like to finish my work at 8, 9 and go out with my friends. That's what I love. He always says like, don't go out and stuff. But that's what I love. That's what I'm doing.
I love that.
Even himself says that he wishes he had more fun time in his 20s. In a couple of videos, he said that he wished he would come back in time and have more fun in his 20s, because he regrets that. So that's one of the points.
But I'm a huge Gary Vee fan also. Let's talk about, since you mentioned that you know, he's one of your online personality that you really admire and you follow.
At the moment, he's my only. So,
okay, that's nice. So let's talk about being authentic online, because there's a fine line when you follow someone that you become what you follow. And that's, in my perspective, not healthy, right? What is your take on this, bro?
And I actually also found out that a lot of my content earlier was not inspired, was heavily inspired by Gary Vee, like the style and how I'm structuring the post. So I kind of noticed that and changed it. So I think you need to, this is all about self-awareness. Like you need to know what you love. You need to know what your taste is. You need to hear as much as you can from others. But that's why I only have Gary Vee, because I don't hear what anybody else says. Like I don't care what anybody else thinks. I don't care what anybody else think about the content or the visual, or if I should do this or that. I just do what I love. I just do what I want. Like if you
can
saw
I give
my
you
last...
an advice right now.
What's, sure, man. Then
I have. I just launched my new course where I teach people how to create the personal brand. And in that course, I have a part of the project where I teach people how to build a reference board. Reference board is a board that you create before you start developing your brand. And in this board, you take many references that can be related to specific traces of your personality. Wow. So let's suppose that you want to communicate a part that's related to your personality on your content and the way that you create your content. The way I do it and the way I recommend people to do it is you go after some personalities like Gary Vee in your example, but you should try to find other parts of your characteristics in other people. And you try to make, you must try to inspire yourself in a very wide, concept behind what he's doing. Because if you do this way, you are not going to be copying. You are going to be inspiring.
Right.
Because the difference between copying and inspiring is very thin. I agree with Jen when he said this. But just to give a very clear example here, in my course, I say, okay, in this case of this course, I'm going to search for some characteristics that will represent graphically the feminine characteristic of a brand. So I typed on Dribbble, on Pinterest, feminine. And I saw all the kinds of things that feminine brands has, like the colors, the shapes, the type. And I just took the type from the feminine characteristic. But did I use the type that everyone else was using? No. I just saw, okay, what are the wide fields of knowledge about this specific topic that everyone's using to be related with feminine fonts, for example? And I discovered that serif fonts with high contrast normally are the most commonly used along the feminine style. But
the general characteristic and what it represents.
Exactly. So to use a feminine font that has this characteristic, this very wide characteristic, you have like 1,000 or maybe 2,000 different fonts that has this characteristic of being serif without curvy serifs and also being high contrasty. So this is one characteristic that I took from this. Mm-hmm. And in the branding, from building your content, you should do the same thing. You take multiple different inspirations and you try to take a very wide field that you can just manage to not copy, but inspire. Take one wide characteristic and make it yours.
Right. Wow.
Yeah, what I try to do, like, for example, when I mainly learn from Gary Vee the mindset. Gary Vee teaches me the mindset and how to think. So, and all of my posts, like mainly also, I talk about mindsets. I don't talk about very actionable tips. That's one of the things I'm working on, actually. But mainly my posts are about mindset. So what I try to do so that I do not copy his words word by word is, like, for example, I watch his video. I change my mindset. I try to relate it back to me. I try to relate it back to a personal experience I had. Like, what experience I had that definitely relates to this mindset? What could I have changed that moment, at that particular moment? If I had this new mindset, what would I have changed?
Right.
So this kind of creates a whole new word, a whole new way to say it that doesn't make me a copy of Gary Vee, but also has the same message. Like, the same message is present. It's the way I said it. I say it that's different.
Right.
Well, this is the right way to do it, because you're not copying. You are just inspiring and in the right way.
Exactly. You're heavily influenced, right? So with you influence and then your own take, your own perspective, it goes out and it makes you original, unique.
My second course on Skillshare, it was about how to create a good-looking carousel. And I teach there my technique, how to create that carousel that goes with a full experience from the beginning to the end. And most of the reviews that I have, and most of the people that follows the course and send me the result in their carousels, mostly they are very similar to the posts I do. They use a very similar filter. They use a similar font. But there's one guy that I don't remember the name right now, that he could take this thing, take the course and create something that's very unique. And it has all his personality and all his look. This is what courses should be
like. Yeah. But I agree.
I said to Jen, man, in some kind of perspective, I feel that the post that he sent me was even better than the ones I do.
That's
very cohesive. It's most amazing.
That's a very, very good feeling.
Because he could take the inspiration. You can see the inspiration. But as the creator of the course, I don't feel he copied at all. I feel that inspiration. And many others, they send me and I feel, okay, you could apply the technique, but it's very similar to what I do. And he was able to translate my technique to his content. And I feel this is amazing. And this is what you do with Gary Vee too, because you can see an inspiration, but it's definitely not a copy, nothing near to a copy.
Yeah.
Yes, that's, yeah. It's all based on personal experiences, like how you translate this message. And this is what makes you stand out also. Like if I copied the message of Gary Vee, for example, nobody would follow me. They would just follow Gary Vee straight away. Like, why would they follow me?
Yeah. Very good perspective. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, that's it. They follow me because of the way I'm saying it, because of my experience, because of my personality. And that's the importance of being yourself.
I like what you mentioned, bro. You mentioned, you know, how to stand out. Okay, let's go. Let's be direct. How can you be authentic in this era, in this digital era? How can you stand out? How can you be authentic in spite of, you know, a lot of competition? There's a lot of people that do what you do. How can you be authentic?
Just like what we were saying, it's you. It's all based on you. Like everything you do, your success, your failures, your experience, the way you stand out, the way you act, it's all based on yourself. Like nobody can say the same message that I'm, the same communication way that I'm doing it. Nobody can create the same style, like of talking, the same humor, for example, the same way of talking. Nobody can do that. Nobody can do that to you, even Jan or to Lucas. Like we're all different. No two are the same. We may look the same. Even twins, they look exactly the same, but they're not the same.
They're different, right?
That's how you identify twins, for example.
There's a sentence that says, no one can jump in the same lake twice in this life because the water is not the same and the cells on your body is going to change too. So nobody can jump twice in the same lake.
I love that. Yeah, first time I hear it.
Very philosophical true. Though. Very philosophical. first time you hear it, you'll say, no, I can't do that. I can definitely make three times, four times.
I can jump and then go up and jump.
But once you figure out, like, yeah.
Surely understand it.
Yes. Water is not the same,
Right. Bro, like, what?
It's a very simple answer to stand out. Just be yourself.
Exactly. As much as
I can talk about this topic, you always go around the circle to just be yourself.
Yeah, everything is good to it.
Yes, that's basically
it. What's your greatest challenge, Kamal? The greatest challenge that you encountered in this niche, in this world that we live in, business related?
Overcoming the people's opinions, overcoming people's fear, the fear of other people's opinions.
Ooh, okay, I love that. Can we capitalize on that? Tell us a story, man.
Yes, well,
no filter. No filter. First of all, I don't want you Lebanese filtering
people,
out.
Yeah. Lebanese people are one of the most judgmental people ever. Yes, I'm truly being honest here. They're the best, it's the best communication, the best population, sorry, the best people, but they're very, very judgmental. So, for example, even your best friend would laugh at you for doing something. And people, the info jumps around from person to person very quickly. The joke jumps around. So one of the main fears was I'm going to post a video. My best friend is going to laugh at me. He's going to tell his friend. His friend's going to tell his friend. And I'm going to become a joke for everybody.
But so, guess what? You are the motherfucker that has put your face out there.
Yes, because I tell them, fuck you. Yeah.
Everybody's just, oh no, he's making this video and he's funny. Okay, but you are the one who has the guts to do it. The other people are just,
Now you see what you're doing. You get my partner, Lucas, hype already. And he's ready to, you know, punch someone in the face, protecting you. Yeah. Now, this is why I like this guy. You see, you feel the power.
And when I first, I'm going to say, literally, when I first posted the video, I imagined in my head the message that my friend is going to send me. Like I said, okay, I'm going to post this video. Then 10 minutes later, my friend's going to send me, ha ha, you're a joke. I imagined this. Well, it didn't happen.
Right.
But he didn't support me in the other way. So it didn't happen both ways. And I just didn't stop from there. The first video I did, and I never stopped. Never cared about what anybody else thinks ever again. Just posted what. I mean, I drew slide 10 in my hand. Did you see the post? The slide 10 where I drew it in my hand. I just did it and posted it. I don't care. Do you imagine that I didn't want to do the thing that made me happy just because people are going to talk? And this is what everybody does, actually. It's like you're putting out your happiness because of other people's opinion. And this is one of the best ways to kind of crumble down. It's very unhealthy. Like, you're putting off your happiness just because somebody's gonna laugh at you. I'm not ready for this. My happiness is above everybody.
You were going to talk about that post that you did, that you just made everything by your hand. And I said that I love that so much that I shared on my stories, and I said, I'm going to give a prize, a monetary prize.
Wow.
Anyone can with an excuse, acceptable excuse after this post, and no replies.
there's not going to be replies. And this is the best example that I give for someone. When I say someone, I don't care what everybody else thinks. Like, everybody's going with the explosions and lights and great carousels, because I just wrote it with my hand and posted it. I don't care. Like, a side of me will think that maybe people will not like it. Maybe I won't get much likes. Maybe I won't get much comments. Some people will think that I'm not going to post it just because of that. And I said, no, fuck that. I'm just going to post it. I don't care. If it doesn't get as much likes as as all of my other posts, it's just a failed post. Nobody is going to unfollow me because of one post.
I really feel that people overcomplicate it, because I don't know how to create. Man, you can create a freaking amazing carousel with 5 words. You don't need more than 5 words.
Exactly.
What's the stress on getting 5 words? Okay, you make 1 word, 1 image. 1 word, 1 image. And you can create a good message with this. There's no need to long text, and people think in very complicated topics to talk about in carousels, and try to fit everything in just one carousel. Just people just don't know how to pass information.
Right.
Because
right.
if you have so many things to say about a specific topic, just split it in multiple carousels instead of making a holy Bible on post. Yeah.
And the opposite of that. Some people have a message that is so short, they try to extend it as much as they can just to fit into 10 slides.
Well, that's difficult to do.
They're so hung up on just the 10 slide carousels that they try to stretch it as much as they can.
Right.
Like, sometimes the message can be said with only one slide, with only 2 slides.
Yeah.
Doesn't have to be 10 slides always. So don't stretch the message.
Yeah.
If it needs 10 slides, give it 10 slides. If it needs a story without a post it on story. Like, it's all about the message, how you want to communicate it.
Exactly.
Yeah, totally.
It always comes down to you being authentic. If I like what you said, that if you don't like what you're doing, if you're just, you know, copying, following, at one point you'll get, you know, stressed out, burn out. Like, because it's not you, right? And
this is why people find struggle with content ideas, with coming up with ideas. It's not because they don't have ideas. It's because they aren't finding ideas to copy from.
Right.
Totally. Ooh,
that's deep, man.
They're not
that's
finding
deep.
Posts to copy from.
That's deep, bro.
Totally.
I have that perspective. When I think it was you that talked about people running out of ideas, if I'm not mistaken. So I had this thought that, is that even possible? I mean, you can look outside, open your window, and you will get something, right? But you know, building it
especially
with a design and, you know, making a construction of it, that's
of
a different point, you know. But, you know, for you to get inspired, you just need to walk, look around.
You just need to think. Yes.
Yes, exactly. Me, I'm having a conversation with the both of you. I get inspired already. I know what I can do, you know. So it's...
Do you know what's the problem on this?
This is a month content. What we're talking about right now is a month content.
Yeah, exactly. The problem that people that loses the creativity in commas here, because what happens is people are doing things all the time. They are always doing something. And this is a block of creativity.
Mm.
Or did you never notice that the biggest ideas comes when you are in the shower, where you are literally doing
my
nothing?
My biggest ideas comes just before I sleep. Just before I sleep.
No, but
just
guys,
before
wait.
Sleep or taking a dump because... Say.
No, before I forgot. The key word there in what you said, I like what Luca said. Creativity block. And that's different from you don't have an idea.
Yeah, right? Totally.
You have an idea, but it's getting, you know, blocked. There's a hindrance.
It's not developing. It's not developing.
Yes,
yeah.
There you go. And that's different from having nothing. And I don't think that a human being, a creator by core, will not generate anything.
Totally.
There are hundreds of ideas every day. Like
exactly.
But
exactly.
What makes somebody different is you take this idea, you write it down, and you develop it. This is where it becomes a content idea. Like ideas are just ideas at first. When you develop them and you double down on them, they become content ideas.
Totally. In the past, the philosophers, they all came up with great ideas that were very ahead of their times. And why do you think that they come with these ideas? Because they didn't have Netflix. They didn't have Facebook. They didn't have Instagram. They didn't have so many things to do. So what did they do? They do their work. And after that, they sit beside a tree and they just stopped and thinking. The word for this in Portuguese is ócio. I don't know how does it translate to English, but is that state that you are just doing nothing and dedicating yourself to develop your mentality ideas, or an idea. When you are doing nothing, your mind needs to be somewhere else. It needs to create in
your
order
mind
for
never
you
shuts
to
down,
not.
Yeah.
Because so you can't be just bored, your mind starts working. Because you are bored. And if you are watching a movie or watching a series on Netflix, for example, I'm not saying that you should never do it because I think it's a kind of extreme assumption to say not do nothing. Just never use YouTube or just never use Netflix. I'm not saying this, but allowing yourself to have nothing in your head for a while is going to help you, because if you are always consuming things that were made by other people, your mind is going to be where they want you to be.
This is very important. Stop consuming, start creating. This is...
That. Stop consuming, start creating.
Start creating.
Wow.
Totally.
Ooh. That's why I like you guys in this episode. See, this is a solid source of information that will get you on the right track. Stop consuming.
Exactly.
And start creating. But you first need to consume this podcast and then you stop consuming.
Bro, when you finish this, start creating. Okay.
The consuming part is also important. Mainly
of course,
if you are
of course.
In any part of creativity, yes. You need to have some. Because consuming is the way that human has to catch things from outside of your head. And if
don't
you take
overconsume.
This as,
don't overuse it.
As inspiration, don't overconsume is the right word. Because if you have some inspiration to create and to apply different things on your projects, you're going to just, there's no other way to get it besides consuming, actually consuming.
Exactly.
So the best way to do it is consume when you need to consume and create when you need to create. Some friends of mine on university, they just thought, I'm always watching movies. And I thought to myself, okay, but how are you able to do all the projects of school if you are always watching movies every single day? And she watched like 3 movies a day. And I couldn't understand how is it possible for her to deliver all this the college projects if she used to watch 3 movies a day. And she said that she was always watching movies while she was working. And I thought to myself, this is why your work could be better. Because you're not creating anything. You are consuming and creating at the same time.
Yes.
This doesn't work well.
It doesn't work. You have to consume, organize your thoughts, recreate them, apply them to yourself, then create.
And there's a big topic about that. But we also need to... be mindful of what you consume, right? Because
totally,
if all you consume are like, you know, random movies or shows, think of it as junk food. I'm not saying movies are junk food, just, you know, visualize them as junk food. And then we have like educational or inspiring YouTube channels about, you know, designing or life, or let's say Gary V's content, right?
Yes.
So you have something that is junk food, and you have content like Gary V, which I would say, let's say a healthy diet, and you choose to consume junk food. You choose to watch all those movies and everything. By the end of the day, even though you consume like what 34 movies, it wouldn't help you because it's not healthy, right?
Yes. So I don't know if I agree with this.
What?
You're getting fat.
I don't know if I agree completely with this. Just because of a single reason. Mm. When you are consuming some kind of movies, even if it's just entertainment, you are able to catch some. If you watch the movie with a, at least it's what I do. I always
the creative look.
Yeah.
No, it's relative. It's a designer look.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's relative. One movie can be, you know, I can, for example, Gary V. Kamal watched Gary V, and he, like, every word that Gary V say will be nutritious for him. Let's say I don't know Gary V and I don't like him. If I watch him, I'm going to get bored. So it's relative. The point is, the premise is,
yes.
You need to be mindful of what you consume. Because in this era, information is everywhere. You see gurus, you see mentors, I've seen people in Instagram say that they can grow your account. But if you look at their account, they're what, 1,000 followers?
You're not growing. I made the post about this. It was one of my best performing posts until the why what is stopping you.
Exactly.
How do you reach 20K?
I also have a perspective on this because let's suppose that we are talking about my girlfriend. My girlfriend helps me in my work, and a big part of what I do in the field of the strategy that I use on my Instagram is studied by her and explained to me. So she studied and she explained it to me.
Right.
And I try to use it because she helps me in the work. We are a co-worker. We work together. Yeah. And because I have too many client work sometimes and I'm not able to keep up with everything. And she always helps me. The quality is the same because I'm the filter, and everything that's that I'm going to deliver to the client is with my perspective and with my review. So the quality is always the same. But she knows many things. She knows more things than I do about Instagram growth, but she doesn't have a page yet. And when she starts a page, she's going to be obliged to start from zero, even though I wouldn't reach the 18K without her.
Mm-hmm.
So when she becomes, because she didn't open her page yet, but when she becomes 100 followers, she already is going to have the credit for the 18K that I have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So this is a different, you have to know the background before judging.
Exactly. That's the reason why you need to be focused on what you consume. You need to assess, because you can easily say like, oh, he's a fake, but does it show in his content? You can easily pinpoint, right? That's where critical thinking comes in. You can easily point the style, the character. It's very easy to pinpoint if a guy is who he says he is.
Yeah. Yes, definitely.
Right?
And if he's selling you a course for $997.
Exactly.
Including information that you can Google right now, he's probably a fake.
Right. And there's a lot.
There's a thing that happens to me a lot, that people send me DMs that I will have to spend my time to think and to process and to answer, that this same person would take 5 seconds to find the same result or even better result in Google. Why the fuck did they send me a DM in the first place? Just Google it.
And the worst thing is they charge you $997 for it. Some people charge you $997 for the course. And people buy it. People buy it. That's the problem. They buy it.
Because they see them. I would ask who you are talking about, but I don't want to get you into trouble.
I'm talking about, let me tell you, Ty Lopez, Dan Locke, Eric Worre, I don't know. These are just a name. There's a kid who's always the ad. He's, what's his name? Connor something. He's selling.
Yeah.
He's a little kid. He's selling a course for $997. It's called the YTA method.
Bro.
Let me tell you what the YTA method is. The YTA method is you create a YouTube video. Put someone who's a voiceover and answer Reddit questions, and you post it. and you start making millions. This is his method. This is what he's teaching in his course. But some coffee. Do you know CoffeeZilla?
Yeah, yeah.
No, I don't.
He's someone who kind of exposes fake gurus.
Yes.
He made.
Yes.
He made
I know. I know. I know him.
He made an interview with him, and it's not working for him. It's not working anymore. But he keeps selling the course. Like the method is not working anymore. But he's keeping on selling the course. So this is also.
You know, someone in the past always said. Also said, the human being is the only being in the world that steps twice in the same rock.
Lakes yeah, and rocks.
True. True. No, you know, guys, the biggest challenge before the post-industrialist, I'm gonna go nerdy in this part. Before in the post-industrialist era, there is a big scarcity of information. Like there's no internet, obviously. Books are in libraries. I don't know if you guys remember libraries. Like, you know, this big room.
What is it?
Ah, come on, man. Big rooms with books. And obviously, if you're not in a rich city or in an abundant town, you don't have access to those kinds of information. You don't have access to those kinds of, you know, rich places with books. Now, in this era, in our generation now, in this digital age, information is everywhere, right? The problem is how to assess if it's authentic, because people don't think anymore. Why I came up with that conclusion, a while ago, my wife, she's a chef, she's a genuine chef, she stumbled upon a YouTube page, and a guy says, you know, claiming that he's a chef and teaching how to cook. The funny part is that guy isn't even a chef. That guy isn't even a cook. And I'm not criticizing him. It's his passion. It's, you know, a culinary enthusiast. And that's not wrong. That's good, right? But if you claim that you are a chef, if you claim something that you are not,
this is where the problem is, yes.
This is where the problem is, and you will be misleading a lot of people that will consume your content. Now, this is the premise of me saying a while ago that you need to be mindful of what you consume. If you're not mindful and you consume those kind of creator, what will happen to you? What they will say, you will follow, and that's not accurate. That will lead you, that will mislead you, and that's where the problem is.
And I totally agree with your point of view on this, because I'm a designer, man. And there is no field in this world where this happens more than with designers. Right. I already said this to you, Jen, and design is very polluted right now, because everyone thinks that you are going to watch 3 videos on YouTube about how to use Photoshop, and you are a professional designer and you want to work in Pentagram. That's one of the biggest agencies of design in the world, because you watched 3 videos on how to create a new file on Photoshop. Knowing Photoshop doesn't make you a designer. Man, designers was born. They existed before computers.
I'm going to be honest with you guys here. Even I don't consider myself a good designer. Like when it comes to design, when it comes to creativity, I don't consider myself as a good designer.
Dude,
as a creator.
We had a long conversation, me and Lucas. That's why my respect to this guy is so high. Remember, Lucas, when we had a talk? But same as you, Kamal, I don't consider myself as a designer. I'm an artist. And you can see in my post, you know, I create. I took up fine arts, man. I'm no designer. I'm an artist. And yes. I think for me, Lucas here, he is a designer. In my perspective,
so like I consider myself a creator. For myself, I consider myself a creator. I'm someone who even in my last post, I might become a chef in 5 years. Like
yes,
I'm someone
yes,
who likes to try things. I'm someone who likes to find his passion. And I tried being a full-time designer. I tried focusing just on design, and I didn't find this what I would love to do in 10 years. I didn't enjoy it as much. I kept it as a skill. I have it as a skill, and it's helping me very much in my creative process on Instagram. But I don't use it as a title. Right now, I consider myself a content creator because this is my title right now. But I have a couple of business ideas. I always write business ideas. I want to start businesses. And like my main goal is to become a business owner, a business starter. This is what my ambition is. I don't want to become the best designer. I don't want to become the best creator. I want to become a businessman. Nice. But design is a skill that I use right now to help me push this ambition through my content. But exactly. I don't call myself a professional designer. Mm. Even when it comes to creativity, I don't think I'm that creative in my posts, but I'm creative in my ideas and my strategies. This is where I'm my strong point is. And this is why I'm thinking of hiring a junior designer to help me with my clients. So Lucas, that I can get...
He's looking for someone. Give him your raise. Lucas.
I have a business card. Wait.
Before we go to the last part, I just have a question. I want, and this goes to the both of you. Have you ever experienced you are either talking to someone or you watch someone either in Instagram or YouTube or in a different event that you know that they don't know what they're saying? You're not saying that they're fake. You just felt it. You just felt it.
All the time. All the time.
Okay, Lucas, go first. Go first. Go first, Lucas.
I even have a topic on this. Man, 90% of the information about color on the internet is wrong. 90%.
Oh, that's max. Yeah. Wow, I love that. I didn't know about that. Because, and I am a fine art graduate.
If you are a fine art graduate, every time that you see some things about the color theory of color, psychology of color, people making up shit, because unless the person who's saying this has a reason why they put a meaning to that color, it's bullshit because they don't know what they are talking about.
I don't know if I commented on your post or someone else's post, but I did this comment. I wrote like a blog post on an Instagram post saying that color has no psychology. There's not a such thing as color psychology.
Yes.
It's how you use the
yes.
color.
Yes, yes, exactly.
But there is something that I won't agree totally, but there is the psychology of color. There is such thing. But they're not how people are saying that it is. Because the brain of humans, they evolve along the time and they get used to the world. Mm. This is why some colors make such some specific feelings. But you see,
yes,
like,
this is what I meant.
The meaning of look, if you see red, what would be the effect of red? People would say a bunch of effects, but red is simply the color of the blood. And through the human evolution, we only have like 10,000 years of the modern society. We just have society for the past 10,000 years, but the human beings are in the same evolution for the past 350,000 years. So what we get from the colors are everything that we evolved with. So whenever we see red, the color red, the most common place to see red wasn't blood. So either it's your blood and it's a bad thing, or your family or your friend's blood and it's a bad thing, or is your food's blood and it's a good thing. So this is why red is a color that punches for attention, because through the last 340,000 years, human only had access to red when they were seeing blood or some kind of plants or some kind of animals.
So now I get where you're going at.
That's something that many people didn't have access to because food was very hard to get, or it's my own blood and I'm fucked up.
And this is something bad.
So this is why the red color has this effect. Unless people are saying things like this, that proves or makes sense to people why this color has this effect, it's bullshit. Like blue, where is the most commonly place to see blue? In the sky. Whenever the sky is blue.
And what are they saying?
It's safe to go out. End of the conversation. And this is why
blue
is the safest color.
What are they saying about blue?
They say like, blue, it's the color that's very formal. It's the color of the sanctity.
This is what I meant.
So many bullshit.
Yeah, like they say blue and red and yellow is the best used for fast food because they entice the people, they make you hungry. And this is where I say no, the colors does not make you hungry. It's because McDonald's and Burger King and KFC, they all use the same color. This is why you're related to it.
Yes.
Because how they use
red makes you hungry because of that sensation that I told you before.
Yes,
either it's the blood of your food or it's your blood.
Yeah.
But do you know why blue is the safest color? Not only because when you go out and the sky is blue, it's because it's safe, but only I have a book here that's about the psychology of color that they ran a study that asks about what is the favorite colors of the people. And blue is the safest color just because it's the color that's the favorite of most people.
Really?
This is the reason that blue is the safest color.
Because everybody loves it,
Because 45% of the population loves blue. It's the favorite color of 45%
that's
of the population.
That's very interesting.
This is why it is a safe color, because you are using the color that people see as the favorite color.
Right.
Simple as that.
How about you, Kamal? Have you ever experienced like meeting someone that you felt that, hey, this guy is just, you know, crazy. It's not
my answer is the same as Lucas. 95% of the times. This is one of the reasons I don't fancy anyone online more than Gary Vee. Because this man, you can feel the authenticity coming from his words. Whenever I hear anybody else talk, like on YouTube, the gurus, the influencers, I just don't buy it. I don't relate to it one bit. I don't, even if it's true, I don't relate to it. I don't think they feel like, they don't make me feel safe.
Right.
Like, it's one of the most important ways of communication is to make the viewer feel relatable, feel safe. And I never felt safe to consume the content of other people other than Gary Vee.
All right. There's a guy, an Asian guy that always uses a suit. I don't know his
Dan
name.
But Dan Lok.
I mentioned his name earlier.
Yeah.
Dan Lok.
He's such a fake. Every time that I see a video of him, I get chills because, man, it's just cringe.
I watch his video and he has a talking Iron Man head, an Iron Man helmet. And for me, that's authentic. I don't care what both of you are saying. As long as you have this Iron Man helmet, it's authentic. Like,
I'm actually thinking of subscribing to YouTube Premium just so I can not watch any ad of his anymore.
Because he has a lot of ads. Yeah.
I watched the video where he talks about the theory that is the sell me this pen. But this is the basic thing about sales. Everyone knows it. It's not his opinion.
It's not his original.
Very overused, yes.
Yeah.
Overused term. Especially from the Wolf of Wall Street. They'd be like, supply and demand.
Yeah.
And this is not how business works.
Yeah. It was before, but not now anymore. The battlefield is very different now, right? It's
now
it's very different.
You have to show actual benefits, actual features, actual value.
All right. So that was a full pack conversation, man. Awesome conversation, awesome learning. Now we reach the part, Kamal, that we will have a good time. People already saw the creative side of you, the business aspect of us, and now it's time for the people to see that we are human. We have, you know, we laugh, we make fun of things, and
yes,
we just relax.
I like this.
Right?
I
okay.
Would you rather save a human or a dog?
Fuck me. What question is this?
We want
to see a dog in danger and a human in danger. Which one would you save?
Can I kill myself?
Wait. You don't know the human and you don't know the dog.
Right.
Don't know the human, don't know the dog. Dog. I'm going to say dog.
You're brutal barbarian, you. You're very barbaric. Next question, Lucas.
Next question. This one is, would you rather lose a finger of your hand or three fingers of your foot?
Ooh.
Or three what?
Three fingers on
your
feet.
Yeah.
On my feet, of course. I like my hands. I use my hands a lot.
Okay. Man, that
I always make this question to people. I always make this question to the people because I think finger toes are so useless. And
I don't know. Like, I'm always wearing socks. I'm always wearing boots. Why would I need them?
Right.
We could just have an extra, like an extra fold on the feet. We have to use the fingers actually.
But hands, right. this is a problem.
Yeah.
All right, guys. So that's it. Those were some silly questions that hope that bring smile to our viewers and listeners. Bro, feel free to promote your social media platform, any projects that you're working at, events, releases. Feel free to promote it.
Well, currently, honestly, I'm working on a podcast just like this one. So I don't want to become a competition for you.
No. Feel free.
But I'm working on a podcast just like this one. And I just want to focus more on YouTube right now. And mainly my main focus is YouTube and Instagram right now. I don't have a specific product that I want to promote. I just want to promote kindness, honestly. Ooh. Be kind to each other.
I love that. Lucas, any promotion?
Yeah, for me, I just released my new course on Skillshare on how to create your personal brand. Also, I'm releasing videos on YouTube every week, and I hope you like it. They are kind of a mix of fun entertainment and also education on graphic design mostly. And also, I'm developing a set of templates to make the design easier for the creators.
Oh, that's so great, man.
What about you, Jen?
I'll be releasing some new collaboration with a German magazine. It's going to be a podcast also. So I'll be releasing it in my content once it's ready. The Creative Talk, you can watch it in YouTube. We have a Spotify account, and it's also being released in IGTV. All right. So, guys, thank you. This is the Creative Talk with me and my buddy Lucas with my brother Kamal.
This was amazing, guys. Hope you enjoyed it.
Peace.
Don't forget to use Comic Sans.
If a fucking egg can do it, why can't you?
Yeah, I love the shirt, bro. I love the shirt. It would be awesome if you can send us.
It's a fucking egg. You can do it.
If a fucking egg can do it, why can't you?
All right, guys. Thank you. This is the Creative Talk. Peace.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.